Now we move into substance abuse. Abusing substances. So let's do some drugs. So, moving past a few things here to get to what's on your test. I had to go to jury duty this morning. They did not select me, so I only missed my first class today. But my goal is to get you all through all of this, and hopefully I won't miss one of these classes. Expectancy effect. When one uses drugs, one tends to get the effect that one expects to get from a drug, unless they have no expectation, in which case anything goes. It's kind of situation based. Expectancy effect is a real thing. It's akin to placebo in the sense that if you believe that you're going to have a good time doing a drug, you're more likely to have a good time. If you believe that the drug might kill you, or you're really scared and you're only doing it to go along with other people, you might have a horrible experience with a drug. And placebo works in a similar sense. I think I've given you this example. They've done studies where they take people and put them into contrived laboratory situations, total strangers to one another, and they start giving them mixed drinks, and then they have them rate their social interactions and how comfortable they feel. And predictably, the more drinks they have, the more comfortable they report feeling. And then observationally, you can see them loosening up and they start having conversations and they get more comfortable with one another. And then you say, well, what accounts for that? And they're like, oh, well, I had a couple drinks. But in those cases, they actually didn't have any drinks. They had virgin daiquiris or, you know, non-alcoholic mixed drinks. So it was their belief that they were drinking alcohol, and the belief that drinking alcohol makes you more socially facile and comfortable that led to them becoming more socially facile and comfortable, and they attributed it to a drug they had not taken. So it's fascinating what can happen with a lot of different drugs. Now, there are certain drugs and certain doses of drugs, expectancy effect really doesn't matter. You hit certain levels of certain drugs, you're going to become unconscious, or you're going to risk death, or you're going to have potentially horrible experiences, because most drug effects are dose dependent. And most users of drugs are not extremely sophisticated users of drugs. And I should hasten to mention that most people who manufacture illegal drugs are not chemists. It ain't Breaking Bad. It ain't a high school chemistry teacher that's manufacturing your meth. It's some dude with zero training in chemistry messing around with highly toxic stuff, hoping that his buddy's recipe works out and doesn't kill him. And if it doesn't, you might get to buy some and hopefully it wouldn't kill you. That's the kind of system that you're working with in the current structure. The way we have it is a really interesting way to have it. We've already talked long ago about the opponent process theory. When you're high, you are going to come down, but you're not going to come down to baseline. You're going to go past baseline in the opposite direction. If you took an upper, you're going to get down. So somebody who's had too much alcohol will have a hangover, right? They had too much alcohol, they get so down you can't even wake them up. They pass out, right? And then it takes a while to get over the effects of the drug and recover and come back to normal consciousness. For people who are taking downers, alcohol is a downer for the most part, but if they take downers, then they get kind of, you know, really jittery and very fidgety and uncomfortable, possibly nauseous. In other words, you have this pleasant experience followed by an unpleasant experience, which becomes a model for classical conditioning. Your body likes homeostasis. It doesn't want to be pulled dramatically from its normal set of mood and perception. When you pull it from its normal state, way in one direction, it will counteract that and go in the opposite direction and then make connections with what were previously neutral stimuli. That was a previously neutral stimulus, but it means it's time to go. Y'all have a great day, and I'll see you on the next time. So where we left off last time was at opponent process theory. We're looking at substance abuse as a class of disorders in the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders, the DSM 5th edition, so DSM-5. We talked about expectancy effect, and we just started getting into opponent process theory. So the idea with opponent process theory, you could remember all the way back to when we talked in the learning chapter about how addictions are so difficult to treat because there's so many complex features of them that are not known to the general public, and people like to label people in negative ways and then just assume that there's something fundamentally wrong with them rather than realizing all humans are susceptible to mental disorders of any type, including substance abuse, and there's some pretty interesting processes that underlie this and that we can put to our advantage in trying to correct things. So an increase in positive feelings is then followed by an increase in negative feelings. You go up and then you come down. Go back to that that particular video if you get a chance, and if you need a refresher. So, you know, you can get high, but then you're gonna crash. So eventually the body learns that, right? When you're in a certain environment, drug administration is likely to happen, and it will signal cravings. It will then put your body in a negative state, anticipating the administration of the drug, so that you don't get out of balance, but come back to balance. In other words, your body is trying to predict the use of the drug to prevent you from going out of homeostasis. It is now conditioning itself to respond to environmental stimuli that were previously neutral, but have been associated consistently with the administration of a drug, which would be your unconditioned stimulus, that causes a withdrawal effect. And now the environment causes the withdrawal effect. In other words, it causes the feelings of cravings. And so those cravings then make people want to use. And I've explained before, you put somebody in rehab for 30 days, then the internal triggers to those cravings will be extinguished when they get out. But then they go back to where they came from, or their work, or their job, or their vehicle, or whatever, where they'd used drugs before. And that environment and the stimuli in the environment will trigger cravings as though they'd always had them. That's the spontaneous recovery of that conditioned reaction. And if they use a drug at that point, it's a bad, bad situation. They don't usually know this. Very few people teach this. And you should, if you get the opportunity, to people who are dealing with addictions. If they can get past that craving and not use, then the craving will go away slowly and it'll stay away longer. In other words, you have to extinguish all these other environmental stimuli that are causing the craving. But if you administer the unconditioned stimulus, the drug again, most people think, oh gosh, I just need to get over this little rough patch. They don't see themselves as about to engage in full-blown addiction again, but they're at risk for full-blown addiction again because administering that conditioned stimulus now makes all the cravings come back as though they had never been extinguished, as though you'd never been to rehab. And that is a huge challenge when you're trying to treat substance abuse. So we look at this situation where people have this increased need for a higher dose to get the same effect, and eventually it doesn't matter what the dose is, you don't get much of an effect out of it, but you need the drug to feel normal. Your body is so adapted to the use of the drug by the environmental stimuli predicting its use that you don't get much of a high out of it, you don't get much of a buzz off of it, but you need the drug to stave off the cravings, which are the withdrawal symptoms, which are often experienced as terrible, depending on the drug. And believe me, that works with any drug. Cigarette smoking is a prime example. We'll be talking about a lot of drugs other than tobacco. But I just talked to a person yesterday who told me that here it is, I think 7 years later, after a stop smoking class that she'd taken with me way back in family medicine, that she's finally 15 days off of those cigarettes. And she had tried time and again, but the cravings were so powerful, the irritation was so massive, the discomfort was so unbearable that every time she quit before, she wasn't able to maintain it. She had nightmares, she had sweats, she had all kinds of stuff. Those withdrawal symptoms kept her going back to the cigarettes, and being off the cigarettes, all these other things in the environment would trigger the cravings, even though she was no longer physically dependent on nicotine. So it's a powerful thing to understand. Substance use is different than maybe some other ways of conceiving it. Now, the DSM no longer looks at a distinction between abuse and dependence, and that's fine. I like to distinguish these because I think it's important to understand how we conceptualize drug use in our society. And when I say drugs, I'm talking about caffeine and nicotine and alcohol and marijuana and every other illicit drug that you can imagine, including prescription pills and heroin and meth, you name it. We're talking about all of these together here. So substance use is simply ingesting a psychoactive substance. moderate amounts, it doesn't really interfere with functioning. So for people who smoke cigarettes, it has a long-term negative health effect, but it doesn't make them crazy. It doesn't make them crash a vehicle. It doesn't make them have fights with people, typically speaking. It doesn't have much effect at all because they're at the point where they're just using the drug not to feel the cravings. It doesn't really have an effect on them, right? People do this all the time. They use alcohol responsibly. They use it in a manner that society accepts. They take a couple drinks at maybe dinner and that's it. They don't get crazy drunk. They don't get a place where they're risky driving a vehicle intoxicated. They don't have fights. They don't get into arguments and things like that. And so they use the drug responsibly. Well, that could be for any drug. People don't want to admit that, but that's true. I know people who have used cocaine who are upstanding members of society. I've never used cocaine, but I used alcohol and marijuana extensively. I haven't used alcohol in almost 20 years, and I haven't used marijuana in a little over 10 years. Actually, short-term memory loss, just over 13 years. So I'm talking about these straight up, not with a moral bent where I think I'm better than anybody else, not with a moral judgment in mind, but just with a practical understanding, because emotions get in the way of our clear thinking sometimes. So when you look at people using drugs, can you use cocaine in any kind of way that would be normal? Well, cocaine wasn't even illegal until the early 1900s. In other words, all society had access to this drug. If the world was going to go to hell in a handbasket because of drug use, it would have done so before the 1920s and 30s. All those drugs were legal. Every drug was legal. They tried to prohibit alcohol, and you see what it did. Prohibition did not bring about the end of alcohol use. It brought about organized crime and terrible societal consequences as a result. So bad that they repealed this constitutional amendment. And now it's a commonplace drug to use, right? We got NASCAR and organized crime as a result of trying to prohibit the use of alcohol, because it was a drug that many people want access to. And it is a drug. Sometimes they say alcohol and other drugs. Alcohol is a drug. It's a drug that has been defined by society as one that under certain circumstances can be used in an appropriate fashion. So use means that you're just simply not causing problems for yourself or other people. You're using it, you modify your consciousness briefly, however long the effect of the drug is, in a mild way, and it doesn't cause problems for you or other people. Abuse causes problems or has the potential to cause problems. Abuse could be long-term or it could be short-term. So it's a pattern, could be a very short pattern, of leading to distress or impairment, fights, fist fights, arguments, crashing vehicles, falling downstairs, which would be hazardous situations, maybe oversleeping because you got a hangover, losing a job, losing a raise, losing respect of other people. Those things could happen with abuse. Abuse could be a pattern that happens on weekends. So for the binge drinker, maybe they don't drink at all during the week. And then once a month, perhaps, they just tie one on, so to speak, and have real problems result as a consequence. I know somebody once had a lot of tequila. What first time they'd ever had a lot of tequila, and they fell down the stairs and busted their face open. That was a hazardous situation. That was an abuse in one situation versus an abuse over time. But the people don't have a need to use, and there's a difference there that you lead into dependence. Dependence is a need to use the drug, whatever the drug is. If it's alcohol, if it's tobacco with the nicotine in it, if it's caffeine because you don't want the headaches from quitting your caffeine, drinking your coffee, if it's heroin, if it's meth, if it's OxyContin, you need it. You need it to function. So it's a maladaptive pattern of use characterized by an increased need to take in higher and higher amounts to achieve the desired effect. That's tolerance. Causes negative effects when it's withdrawn. So you have the withdrawal symptoms, you have the cravings, but the cravings aren't just, I really want something. Cravings are very powerful experiences of suffering. People might get nauseous, they might get feverish, they might get jittery, they might get, whatever. They certainly get agitated, and the drug removes that. And so there's this powerful need to get hold of the drug to avoid this negative withdrawal symptom. So you also usually have unsuccessful efforts to control use, where a lot of effort is expended seeking the drug or recovering from its effects. So you see the distinction, I hope, between use, which could be socially appropriate no matter what drug it is, no matter what you think about drugs, substance abuse, which is where you have distress, impairment, or hazardous situations as a possible outcome, and dependence, where you have this chronic use, where you need high levels to get the desired effect, and usually the desired effect becomes eventually staving off these withdrawal symptoms. And you have people who are like, I could quit, but then they really can't quit. They try, but they fail, and they feel bad. They think they're a failure, but this is a point at which they've really become addicted to the drug, and they will spend a lot of time seeking it out and recovering from its effects. And multiple dependencies are common. So oftentimes people will have dependency on more than one drug. And that might be tobacco and alcohol. It might be tobacco and marijuana. It might be alcohol and OxyContin. It might be anything. But comorbidity between substance dependencies are common. But substance abuse is interesting when we start to look at it from a societal level, because we try to legislate and regulate it. And in certain cases, you could even have dependence without abuse, such as in the case of cancer patients using morphine for pain control. So my grandmother never touched alcohol, as far as I know. She didn't touch tobacco. She didn't touch any drugs. She lived a life clean and sober. Never had an issue. And then in the last stage of her life, she had cancer, and it created such great pain that eventually when she was in the hospital, they used morphine to control it. And at the last days of her life, the pain was so great that the morphine couldn't control it. Now, she wanted heroic efforts taken to try to stay alive. She was scared to die like most people. And I loved her, and she had great faith in God, and she taught me some of that. But at the same time, there was this woman who was afraid to die. And she said, please do whatever you can for me. And what they could do at that point was try to alleviate the pain. But at the very end, the pain was so bad that she would just writhe in agony when she had the full morphine drip. They couldn't go any higher legally or ethically. But at that point, it wasn't doing any good. So they didn't quit it either, because to do so would have killed her. She couldn't have handled withdrawal symptoms that they could have tapered it down, but she didn't have many days left. They just left her on it. She was dependent on morphine at that point, because it was part of a prescribed medical regimen. For a lot of people who wind up abusing prescription drugs, that's oftentimes how it starts. They take them for a legitimate need, medical community prescribes it to them, and then it has other effects that they become dependent upon.